माय बिलवड मास्टर्स, कंपोज्ड बाय श्रील भक्ति विज्ञान भारती गोस्वामी महाराज। श्री श्रीमद भक्ति रक्षा श्रीधर गोस्वामी महाराज, हैप्पीली एंड्यूरिंग डिफिकल्टी फॉर द सर्विस ऑफ श्री गुरु। श्री श्रीमद भक्ति रक्षा श्रीधर गोस्वामी महाराज एंड श्री श्रीमद भक्ति हृदय वन गोस्वामी महाराज वंस वेंट टू अम्बाला टू असिस्ट इन सेटिंग अप अ स्पिरिचुअल एजुकेशन एग्जीबिशन एट कुरुक्षेत्र एज पर द डिजायर ऑफ श्रील प्रभुपाद। बींग अनेबल टू फाइंड अकोमोडेशन फॉर देमसेल्व्स, दे रिसॉर्टेड टू स्पेंडिंग द नाइट अंडर अ ब्रिज वेयर दे बेयर्ड द कोल्ड वेदर बाई एम्ब्रेसिंग ईच अदर फॉर वार्म्थ एंड रिमेंबरिंग कृष्णस पास टाइम इन विच ही स्पेंड द नाइट इन द फॉरेस्ट विद सुदामा वाइल सर्विंग देयर गुरु। द नेचुरल ह्यूमिलिटी ऑफ वैष्णव्स। श्रील श्रीधर गोस्वामी महाराज एंड माई गुरु महाराज, देन नोन एज श्री हाई ग्री ब्रह्मचारी, वंस प्रीच इन द सिटी ऑफ मद्रास, नाउ चेन्नई। एट दैट टाइम अ डिबेट बिटवीन डॉक्टर राधा कृष्णन, हु कंट्रारी टू हिज नेम वॉज अ स्ट्रॉन्ग प्रोपोनेंट ऑफ द स्कूल ऑफ अद्वैतवाद, नॉन ड्युअलिटी और इम्पर्सनलिज्म, एंड डॉक्टर नागराज शर्मा, हु कंट्रारी टू हिज नेम वॉज अ फर्म प्रमोटर ऑफ द्वैतवाद ड्युअलिटी, वॉज पब्लिश इन द इंग्लिश डेली पेपर द हिंदू इन द फॉर्म ऑफ अ सीरीज ऑफ आर्टिकल्स। थ्रू दीज आर्टिकल्स both men put forth arguments in favor of their respective faiths while refuting the other's arguments. This continued for some time until the Dvaitvadis and Advaitavadis of Madras decided to organize a debate between the two men under the chairmanship of a representative from the Gaudiya Math. Whatever conclusion the chairman would reach was to be considered final and acceptable for all. When the local residents approached Guru Maharaj with a proposal to appoint a representative from the Gaudiya Math institution as a chairman for the debate, he was very pleased and requested Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj to accept the chairmanship. In a humble manner befitting a Vaishnav, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj accepted the proposal. In the meantime, Guru Maharaj received a telegram from Srila Prabhupada ordering him to come to Kolkata. When Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj heard about Srila Prabhupada's message, he said to Guru Maharaj, "O High Grieve Prabhu, I will not able to accept the post of the chairman for the debate if you are absent." Guru Maharaj replied, "Although Srila Prabhupada will certainly be pleased if I were to leave now for Kolkata as he instructed, I firmly believe that he will be much more pleased to hear that the Gaudiya Math was awarded the chairmanship of a debate to be held in such a great assembly of dignitaries, even if it results in a slight delay in my reaching Kolkata." On the day of debate, Srila Bhakti Rakshar Sridhar Goswami Maharaj was formally appointed as the chairman. In his opening address, he humbly said, "Although I am not qualified to hold the post of chairman for this debate, I have accepted the position in order to fulfill the instructions and desires of the Vaishnavas and the noble members of the society." When the debate started, Dr. Radha Krishna spoke first and attempted to establish the superiority of Advaitavad. Afterward, when Dvaitavadi Dr. Nagraj Sharma was asked to establish his viewpoint, he began his address by saying, "Because Vaishnavas are humble by nature, they introduce themselves by saying, 'Daso Asmi, I am your servant.' Advaitavadis, however, being unable to appreciate such dignity, are always eager to proudly introduce themselves by saying, 'Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahm, the absolute truth.'" Indirectly referring to the humble conduct of Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj, he then said, "Truly speaking, there is no need for Vaishnavas to exhibit their humility in all places and circumstances." After this, Dr. Nagraj Sharma went on to establish his views on Dvaitavad. At the end of the debate, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj said in his concluding speech as chairman, "It is a fact that a person's pride becomes inflated when he associates with those lesser than him. But such false pride can never enter a person who always remains in the association of transcendental personalities. Just as a father naturally behaves as a senior in front of his son and as a junior in front of his father, a person who associates with those who have attained the topmost perfection, service to the Supreme Personality, no longer externally demonstrates humility by force. Rather, divine humility naturally manifests in his heart and is reflected in his conduct. But if a person associates with someone inferior to him, then pride is bound to arise in his heart. Being humble is not a mechanical process, but rather a natural byproduct of spiritual realization. Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami has referred to himself by saying, Jagai madai haite muise papisht, purise kit haite muise lagisht, mor naam sune jai tar punne khai, mor naam lai jai tar paap hai, eman nirghan more keba kirpa kare, ek nityan bina jagat bitare. Shri Chaitanya Chaitamrit Adi Leela 5.205 and 207. I'm more sinful than Jagai and Madai, and even lower than a worm in a stool. The pious activities of that person who hears my name are completely destroyed. Anyone who utters my name commits a sin. Who in this world but Nityananda could show his mercy to such a wild person as me? Srila Rupa Goswami, the foremost authority of the realm of bhakti, has expressed similar sentiments. Adharo api aparadanam, avivek hato api aham, tat karuna pratiksho asmi, prasida mai madhava. Stav Mala, Volume 1, Pranam Pranayv Stav, 14. Although I am a mine of offenses, and although I cannot tell right from wrong, I still hope for your mercy. O Madhav, please be merciful to me. Shri Madhav Saraswati, a Vaishnav Kavi, means poet from South India, has expressed his humility as follows. Gyan avlambaka kechit, kechit karma avlambaka, vayam tu hari dasanam, pad tran avlambaka. Some are inclined to gyan, and others are inclined to karma. We, however, are inclined to take shelter of the shoes of the lotus feet of Sri Hari's servants. By analyzing the humble expressions of such great personalities, one can clearly understand the actual position of the impersonal Advaitavadis as compared to that of Dvaitavadi Vaishnavas. The former of the two groups possesses the self-conception of Aham Brahmasmi and Pasho Bad Bhavet Jiva Pash Mukta Sadashiva. A person bound by the ropes of Maya is a Jiva, but when he is released from those bonds, he becomes Sadashiva. While members of the latter group conceive of themselves in the following manner: Mad Janmam Phalam Idam Madhu Kaitabare, Mad Prathniya Mad Anugra Esha Eva, Tad Bhritya Bhritya Paricharaka, Bhritya Bhritya Bhritasya Bhrityam Iti Mam Smara Lokanatha. Mukund Mala Stotra 25. O Loknath, the Lord of all, O slayer of the demons Madhu and Kaitav, please be merciful to me and grant my prayers that you may remember me as a servant of the servant of the servant of the servant of your servant servant. Exposing impostures. Once, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj and his godbrother, Shri Swati Karananda Prabhu, who later became known as Shri Srimad Krishnadas Babaji Maharaj, were preaching in Ambala on the order of Srila Prabhupada. There, they met the superintendent of the Ambala railway station, who repeatedly requested them to meet a so-called sadhu proclaiming himself to be Bhagwan. Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj explained to the superintendent that it is grossly improper to accept a mortal person as Bhagwan. And Sri Swadhi Karananda Prabhu declined by saying, we do not have time to meet such people. Still, the superintendent strongly insisted. although they had absolutely no interest in meeting an impostor. They relented and accompanied the superintendent to meet the so-called sadhu at the railway station. After arriving there, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj initiated a conversation by saying, "Please introduce yourself to us." The so-called sadhu replied in English, "I am Lord Krishna, I am Muhammad, I am Christ, I am Buddha, I am Chaitanya." Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj told him, "You are speaking to a sensible person, please speak accordingly." Hearing Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj's words, the fraudulent sadhu became irritated and said, "Joseph Stalin, the leader of the Soviet Union, is a dog to me. Franklin D. Roosevelt, the President of United States of America, is a cat to me." Seeing their Gurudev becoming angry, his disciples asked Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj, "Why are you upsetting Bhagwan?" The superintendent said, "Bhagwan and his devotees are having a conversation. Do not interfere." Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj then asked the impostor, "What is the cause of your irritation?" Without being goaded or pressed, the impostor himself explained, "I sacrificed so much for India's independence, but no one stepped forward to help me financially when my wife fell sick in Delhi. She died as a result. Am I mad that I will continue to sacrifice my life for those who have done nothing to help me? A soldier who fought so diligently for their freedom. They have cheated me, and now it is my turn to cheat them." Being shocked to hear this, many of the impostor's prominent guests left one by one. Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj turned to Sri Swadhikarananda Prabhu and said, "Ja palayate sa jivati. Those who discard the association of this wicked person will be saved. All others will be trapped." Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj, a recipient of Srila Prabhupada's mercy, had an uncanny ability to identify impostors, uproot their deception and expose their true nature to everyone. Defending the authenticity of Srimad Bhagavatam. Once, a scholar told Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj, "Many people do not accept Srimad Bhagavatam among the authentic scriptures Sri Vyasadeva manifested, and at least to some extent, their argument seems logical." He explained, "A linguistic comparison between Bhagavatam and Vyasadeva's other scriptures reveals troubling dissimilarities. It is evident that Bhagavatam's modern morphology contrasts with that of the ancient language used in Vedvyas' other scriptures. Naturally, this leads many to question not only the era of Bhagavatam's origin, but its authenticity as well. What is your opinion on this?" Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj's response was extraordinary. "Oh yes," he replied, his words dripping with sarcasm. "Srimad Bhagavatam was certainly composed yesterday." He then earnestly asked the scholar, "Is antiquity the sole factor by which a scripture's authenticity is to be assessed? Should we not assign greater value to a relatively recent text whose gravity and depth is far superior to the ancient text against which it is being compared? Should the potency of the atom bomb, which is undisputedly the deadliest and most powerful weapon ever created, be dismissed merely due to its recent invention?" He continued, "Srimad Bhagavatam is the butter churned from the Bhakti Shastras and Upanishads. The date of its origin is irrelevant to the superiority of its depth. Whether ancient or composed yesterday, it remains far superior to the Upanishads." Srila Vrindavan Das Thakur Mahashay, a prominent personality in Gaudiya Vaishnava lineage, has stated, "Chari Vedi Dadi Bhagavat Navneet Mathai Lena Shukh Khai Lena Parikshit." Sri Chaitanya Bhagavat Madhya Khand 21.16. The four Vedas are like yogurt, and Srimad Bhagavatam is like butter. Sri Shukdev Goswami churned that yogurt into butter, and Sri Parikshit Maharaj relished the result. Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj concluded, an unqualified person's inability to access the true worth of an invaluable, albeit recently created object, is a testament to his foolishness. An intelligent person, however, accepts apprenticeship at the feet of a learned mentor who can instill in him the ability to assess an object's value based on merit alone. On knowing the unknowingable, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj once preached in Bombay, now Mumbai, before the establishment of a Gaudiya Math there. She MP engineer, the first advocate journal of independent India, was at that time the chairman of the Theosophical Society. And he invited Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj to speak at one of the society's gatherings. Because many speakers had been invited, each speaker was asked to keep his speech to a concise 15 minutes. In his speech, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj mentioned that the Supreme Lord Shri Bhagwan is Advaita Gyan Paratattva, which means one cannot attain true knowledge about his supremacy simply by one's own endeavors, nor can he be made understood by anyone else. Naim Atma Pravachanena Labhya Na Medhya Na Bahu Na Shruten. Katha Upanishad 1.2.23. The Supreme Soul can never be attained by one's intelligence, by delivering sermons, nor by extensively hearing about him. Upon the conclusion of Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj's presentation, Shri MP engineer posed a question to Srila Maharaj before he could even take his seat. Maharaj, you have just professed Shri Bhagwan to be unknown and unknowable. If this is true, then for what purpose have you given up the material comforts of this world and accept the renounced order of life if not to attain him? Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj immediately responded, Shri Bhagwan can most certainly be known. Hearing this, Shri MP engineer good humoredly said, I must admit that according to my vision, you do not appear to be a renunciate in any true sense, because you have instantly changed your stance on this matter, just like a lawyer. Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj replied, you have given me a time limit. I was able to express only one viewpoint of a highly profound subject matter, and the allocated time was over before I could mention the other viewpoint. Therefore, I could not complete the description of my desired subject matter in the allotted time. Hearing the words of Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj, Shri MP engineer said, you began explaining a highly insightful topic in a very beautiful way. Therefore, please take another 50 minutes and complete your presentation on this subject matter. Srila Maharaj then went on to firmly establish the full, proper Siddhanta. Although the Shastras mention that Shri Bhagwan is the non-dual absolute truth, it is mentioned in the same scriptures that if He, the Supreme Absolute Truth, does not possess the ability to make Himself known to whomever He desires, then His supremacy and His qualities of being limitless and infinite are immediately called into question. Therefore, it is said, Yam evesha vrinuntu tenu labhyas tasya asha atma vivrinunti tanum syam. Katha Upanishad 1.2.23. The Supreme Soul is attainable only by one upon whom He has bestowed His mercy. To such person, He reveals His personal form. In other words, it is impossible for one to gain knowledge about Bhagwan through one's own endeavors or through the help of someone on the same level of devotion. However, when the Supreme Lord observes in one the inclination to serve Him, He imparts knowledge by which one can understand Him, either directly or through one of His associates. Ata Shri Krishna Namadi na bhaved grajya indriyai sevan mukhehi jivado swayam eva surate adha. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 1.2.234. The name, form, qualities and pastimes of Shri Krishna cannot be perceived by the material senses. They become manifest when one's senses, starting with the tongue, are permeated with the desire to render service. Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj's presentation had such a profound effect on Sri M.P. Engineer that when Srila Prabhupada Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur later visited Bombay, he humbly requested Srila Prabhupada not to deprive the city's residents of his Vichardhara line of philosophical conceptions and to establish a mutt there. Later, as per the instruction of Srila Prabhupada, a property was rented in Bombay to establish a Gaudiya Mutt, from which the preaching of the Gaudiya line in that city was initiated. The messengers of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Vani. Once, Guru Maharaj, at the time Sri Hai Griv Brahmachari, went along with Sri Srimad Bhakti Swarup Siddhanti Goswami Maharaj, then Sri Siddh Swarup Brahmachari, and Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj to preach in Sialat, East Bengal, now Bangladesh, where they had been invited to speak at a 3-day spiritual function. On the first day, Sri Siddh Swarup Brahmachari, in his address, made use of very straightforward but harsh and immoderate words while establishing the superiority of the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu over the popular Mayavad philosophies prevalent at that time. He referred to Vivekananda, whose name means one who takes bliss in having intelligence, as V. Vivekananda, or one who takes bliss in being ignorant, and to Ramakrishna Paramahansa as Ramahamsa, or a large but wordless swan. Upon hearing these epithets, many residents of Sialat became irritated. That night, leaflets that denounced the Gaudiya Mutt and demanded the cancellation of the function were published and distributed all over town. The next day, Sri Hai Griv Brahmachari met with the governor, the district judge, who expressed his concern about safety and said that since the event had faced such great opposition, it would be advisable to cancel the remaining 2 days of the function, just to rule out the possibility of any undesirable incident. Sri Hai Griv Brahmachari assured the judge that the speaker who had used incendiary words the previous night would most definitely not be speaking again, and that only he and Sri Srimad Bhakti Rakshar Sridhar Goswami Maharaj would address the audience. The judge replied, "It is on your assurance alone that I will allow the function to continue. I will make all the necessary arrangements for providing increased security, but please be mindful of the content of your Harikatha." The next evening, the venue was filled with antagonistic objectors. Sri Hai Griv Brahmachari was the first to address the crowd, and he began by praising the hospitality of the Sialat people. After he finished his speech and established his objective, he conceded the podium to Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj. During his presentation, Srila Maharaj said, "Our Guru Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada, has taught us that in our preaching, we are delivering the message of Swayam Bhagwan Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Himself. Our only purpose in coming here is to deliver, through fearless yet fair speech, the Vani teachings that incessantly flow from Srimad Bhagavatam, the natural commentary on Vedanta Sutra, as it has been presented by Srimad Mahaprabhu and our line of Guru Varga, which includes Sri Raghunath Das Goswami, Srila Jeev Goswami, Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami and others who make up our Bhagavad Parampara. We are not here to preach with the apprehension and shyness of a lady hiding her face behind a veil. What to speak of the philosophical doctrines of personalities like Sri Shankaracharya, Jaimini, Patanjali, Kannad and so on. The ideology manifested by Swayam Bhagwan Sri Gauranga Mahaprabhu is unparalleled and vastly superior to the ideologies established by even the previous 4 Vaishnavacharyas, Sri Ramanuja, Sri Madhvacharya, Sri Nimbaditya and Sri Vishnu Swami. Through his teachings, he has highlighted the shortcomings of such doctrines and has conclusively defeated all erroneously fabricated philosophies. Therefore, in our presentation of Sriman Mahaprabhu's ideology, how is it possible that the ideologies of persons like Vivekananda, Ramakrishna Paramhans, and Bhandarkar will not be contested. Moreover, we are simply messengers of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Our duty is merely to deliver his teachings. If anyone in this assembly has any objections, he may kindly address them to Sriman Mahaprabhu, Srila Ved Vyas, or Srila Rupa Goswami. Although we have unflinching faith in their Vichara-dhara, line of ideology, we will undoubtedly surrender to any person who can present an ideology superior to that presented by Sriman Mahaprabhu. But if such a person is not present in this world, what intelligent being would be unwilling to follow or feel uninspired by such a highly auspicious spiritual path as the one described by Sriman Mahaprabhu and his followers? Srimad Bhagavat has clearly described Sri Krishna as Swayam Bhagwan. Yete Chamskala Pumsam Krishnastu Bhagwan Swayam. Srimad Bhagavatam 1.3.28. All avatars are either plenary portions or portions of the plenary portions of the Supreme Person, but Krishna is the original personality of Godhead. Furthermore, Krishna himself has stated in Bhagavad Gita that he is the ultimate object of surrender in such verses as Sarva Dharman Paritajya Mam Ekam Sharanam Raja Aham Tvam Sarpapebhyo Moksha Shami Ma Shucha. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 18.66. Completely abandoning all dharma, take shelter of me alone. I will free you from the reactions of your sins. Do not lament. Manmana bhava madbhakto madyaji mam namaskuru mam eva yashi satyam te pratijani priyo asmi me. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 18.65. Offer your mind to me, become my devotee, worship me and offer pranams to me. By this you shall attain me. I swear this truth to you because you are dear to me. Ananyas chintyomam ye janah paryupasate tesham nitya bhuktanam yog shem vahamyaham. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 9.22. For those who are devoid of other desires, who are always absorbed in contemplation of me, and who always worship me, I personally carry their necessities and preserve what they presently have. Therefore, what benefit is there in accepting the ideology of Ramakrishna Paramahansa, who advocates the worship of devatas, demigods? Such worship is averse to Srimad Bhagavatam 4.31.14, which has firmly established Yatha Taror Mool Nishchanen Tripanti Tad Skanda Bhujav Shakha Prano Aparacha Yathindriyanam Tathaiva Sarvaharanam Achut Jaya. Just as pouring water on the root of a tree nourishes its trunk, branches, leaves and sprigs, and as giving food to the stomach nourishes all the senses and bodily limbs, all the demigods are automatically worshipped when one worships Sri Achyuta Bhagavan. The philosophy of Vivekananda is Jeev Prem Kare Jai Jan Sei Jan Seviye Che Ishwar. One who has love for living entities actually serves the Supreme Lord. However, we see that his followers kill and eat animals, and we must therefore conclude that in this slogan, the word Jiva as used by Vivekananda refers only to human beings. But the true meaning of the word Jiva refers to all living entities. You should all deeply consider these points. There is no need for us to say anything further. You are all free to make complaints against any imperfection in our methods of delivery. But you must know for certain that the philosophy we have presented remains immaculately pure at all times, without the slightest trace of contamination. After Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj concluded his speech, the audience responded with thunderous applause. Indeed, they were truly pleased as they requested that the organizer extend the function for an additional 15 days. In this way, the preaching of Sriman Mahaprabhu's Vani in the city of Sylhet was a great success. As Sylhet was well known as a city with good quality lime. The residents, in their appreciation, arranged for a wagon load to be used in the service of whitewashing the walls of Sri Chaitanya Math, the temples at Yogpit, and other buildings in Sriman Mahaprabhu's Shrida Mayapur. His non-duplicitous glorification of a junior godbrother. Every year, after the Godpunim festival, Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj used to invite many of his godbrothers to attend a function at his Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math at Koler Ganj, Navdeep Dham. During one such occasion, my Guru Maharaj, after the completion of the Godpunima festival, was engaged in managing the affairs of Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math, such as bidding farewell to the pilgrimage and settling accounts. And despite his most sincere desire and efforts to reach Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math in a punctual manner, he arrived somewhat late to the assembly of Vaishnavas gathered there. Upon seeing that Guru Maharaj had arrived, Sri Srimad Bhakti Kamal Madhusudan Goswami Maharaj said, "Madam Maharaj, you have arrived very late today. We have been waiting for you for a long time." Guru Maharaj replied, "Maharaj, because many pilgrims had come to our mutt for Navdeep Dham Parikrama, we have incurred a great debt. Today I was busily engaged in settling these debts and resolving other issues so that the services of the mutt can continue. You and all the other Vaishnavas present, please forgive me for my delay." Sri Srimad Bhakti Vichar Yayavar Goswami Maharaj, having heard the response of Guru Maharaj, said, "Na arambhan arabhet kochit." One must never attempt to unnecessarily increase one's material opulence. Hearing this, Sri Srimad Bhakti Rakshar Sridhar Goswami Maharaj said, "Madam Maharaj, I would like to reply to Pujyapad Yayavar Maharaj's comment." "Yes, Maharaji, as you please," Guru Maharaj replied. "For an elephant," Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj began, "a stick of sugar cane is as insignificant as naswar, snuff tobacco. Whereas for an ant, the same sugar cane sticks is like a mountain. An activity that to us may seem like a huge endeavor is nothing but an insignificant task for Pujyapad Madhav Maharaj. He can perform such deeds without any difficulty. In this regard, I have had first-hand experience. Srila Prabhupada had sent Pujyapad Madhav Maharaj, then known as Sri Haigriva Brahmachari, and me to acquire some land at the meeting place of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Rai Ramanan at Kovur, near the banks of the Godavari River, in order to establish Sriman Mahaprabhu's footprints, Pad Pitha, there. After many days of endless endeavor, I said, 'Haigriva Prabhu, Srila Prabhupada has sent us here with great hope to obtain a piece of land on which to establish Mahaprabhu's Padapitha.' My Brahmachari name given by Srila Prabhupada was Ramanandas, and this is the meeting place of Mahaprabhu and Ramanandrai. Although we have tried our best to acquire land, we have not been successful. What is your opinion? Should we stay here longer or should we leave for Madras for preaching?" Sri Haigriva Prabhu replied, "It is my feeling that we have thus far not made any special endeavors. I think we should continue our efforts for some time more." Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj then mentioned to all the Vaishnavas present, "You may estimate his capability from this statement of his. The apparent end point of our attempts was for him a beginning point of fresh endeavors. Later, through his tireless efforts, a plot of land was acquired in Kovur and a mutt was established there." Srila Prabhupada used to refer to Sri Haigriva Brahmachari as having volcanic energy. Sri Vasudev Prabhu used to call him Sarva Ghate, one who excels in completing all types of tasks. My personal view about Pujyapad Madhav Maharaj is that he is comparable to none other than Sri Vakreshwar Pandit, an associate of Sriman Mahaprabhu, who could dance continuously during kirtan for 72 hours without being fatigued. Beyond the glorification of my Guru Maharaj, this narration relates a significant lesson. Although Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj was senior to my Guru Maharaj, having joined the mutt and having been awarded sannyas vesh earlier than him, he did not hesitate in observing and speaking about the good qualities of his junior. Sri Golok Vrindavan is the topmost abode, superior to all other Vaikuntha planets, and it remains eternally free from even the faintest scent of jealousy and envy. Because Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj is among the great personalities who are sincere, nirmatsara, followers of the loving residents of this very Golok Vrindavan, he remains free from the material limitations of this world and was therefore able to offer such genuinely humble and non-duplicitous praise. The repugnance of Pratishtha. A devotee once asked Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj in his kirtan entitled Vaishnav Ke, Srila Prabhupada has written, Tomar Pratishtha Sukere Vishta, your prestige is hog excrement. Why has he specifically chosen the words Sukrer Vishta, the stool of hogs, to describe Pratishtha worldly prestige? Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj replied, Pratishtha is abominable and worthless, and it is only proper to compare it to an equally worthless object. Here the question may arise as to why Srila Prabhupada referred specifically to the excrement of hogs, when human excrement seems just as worthless. Because hogs are nourished by consuming human excrement, it is considered to have at least some value. The excrement of hogs, however, is absolutely worthless, because all species of animals avoid it, including hogs. Had Srila Prabhupada discovered a more worthless substance than the stool of hogs, he would have utilized that substance in this metaphor. Encouraging others to speak Harikatha. Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj once inquired from me, if I were to ask you, could you deliver a spiritual discourse on stage? No, Maharaj, I replied, I'm just a newcomer. How can I deliver a speech when I'm not well versed in scriptural conclusions? Srila Maharaj further asked, tell me, what is your view on Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? I replied, I have no independent view on Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is Bhagwan himself, but I can try to present before you whatever I have heard and understood from Sri Guru and the Vaishnavas. Maharaj consented, and I described whatever I knew to the best of my ability. Srila Maharaj then asked, what do you know about the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the process to follow those teachings? I replied, Sriman Mahaprabhu has described the four prerequisites for performing Krishna Kirtan. Trinadapi sunichena taror eva seshuna amanina manadena kirtanya sadahari Sri Shikshtashtak 3rd. A chanter of Kirtan must consider himself to be more worthless than a straw in the street and more tolerant than a tree. He must be devoid of all pride and he must offer due respect to all. Sriman Mahaprabhu is the very embodiment of these four principles. In Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Adi Leela 3.20, Sri Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami has recorded Sriman Mahaprabhu's as saying, Apani Acharya Bhakti Shikhainu Sabare, I shall teach bhakti to everyone by practicing it myself. And Apani Na Kaile Dharma Shikha Na Jai, if I do not practice it myself, then pure bhakti, which is the essential principle of religion, will not be taught. Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj said, what you have just spoken easily develops into a full speech by simply adding a few more details. He went on to describe how Trinadapi Sunichena, the quality of being humbler than a blade of grass, manifests automatically by being in the association of advanced devotees. Other than Seva Sadhan, he said, no sadhan is required. The fruit of cultivating a mood of service. One day, Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj gave me the following instructions. Instead of paying attention simply to a kirtan's melody and rhythm, one should instead always focus on its deep meaning and try to follow the moods of the Vaishnava who composed it. Try to become Ugrashava, that is, always hear the narrations of Bhagwan's pastimes exclusively from the lotus lips of advanced devotees, for such narrations are tremendously powerful. I asked, Maharaj ji, How will it be possible for me to always hear from advanced devotees? Srila Maharaj replied, Everything is possible by sincerely serving the Vaishnavas. Serve advanced devotees whenever you receive the opportunity to do so. Firmly fixing Srila Maharaj's advice in my heart and never allowed an opportunity to serve advanced devotees pass me by. In my life, I have served them in countless ways, including providing them warm bathing water, washing their clothes, cleaning their rooms, assisting them in their travels, attentively hearing their Harikatha and discussions and closely observing their conduct. Being pleased with my mood of service, the many disciples of Srila Prabhupada who visited our mutt would often specifically request Guru Maharaj to assign me to their service during their visit. In this way, I received the rare fortune of serving some of the most exalted Vaishnavas, each of whom was capable of purifying the whole world. In their service, I directly witnessed their standards for performing bhajan, in addition to receiving the golden opportunity to hear the deepest, subtlest, and most secret teachings of the scriptures from their lotus lips. Saraswati Putra, the son of Srila Saraswati Thakur. I once went with a few Punjabi devotees to Sri Navdeep to have darshan of Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj. However, when we reached Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Gaudiya Mutt, Srila Sridhar Gosai Maharaj's sevak informed us that we would be unable to meet with Srila Maharaj as he was feeling unwell. We offered pranam from outside Srila Maharaj's room and were preparing to leave. When Srila Maharaj called for his sevak, "Who has come?" he asked. I heard voices. The sevak mentioned my name and Srila Maharaj told him to call us. When we entered his room, he expressed a bit of displeasure with me. He asked, "Were you about to leave without meeting me?" "No, Maharaji," I said. "It's not like that. We were about to leave only because we were told you were unwell. We did not want to disturb you, and so we offered pranam from outside." Srila Maharaj then spoke about his different preaching missions to Punjab during the time Srila Prabhupada was physically present. He particularly mentioned the warm hospitality of the Punjabi people. He then said, "We are Saraswati Putra, the sons of Srila Prabhupada, Bhakti Siddhant Saraswati Goswami Thakur, and we will remain healthy as long as we engage in the service of Saraswati." Saraswati is also the name of the goddess of speech. By speaking about Bhagwan and Bhagwan's associates, we'll be greatly fortunate if by destiny we leave this world performing Kirtan and Harikatha. Glorification of Pujyapad Sridhar Maharaj by Srimad Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj. His appearance and early life. Pujyapad Sridhar Goswami Maharaj commenced his manifest pastimes at an auspicious moment on the ninth day of the fourth night of the new moon in the month of Kartik, Saturday, 10 October 1895, in the village of Haipania in Kalna, Bardhaman, West Bengal. When he appeared, he accepted the foremost scholar Sri Yukta Upendra Chandra Bhattacharya Vidyaratna Mahode as his father and Srimati Gauri Devi as his mother. Both of his parents were devoutly religious and noble individuals dedicated to the Lord, and they gave their jewel-like son the name Sri Ramendra Sundar Bhattacharya. Later, beginning in 1923, Sri Ramendra Sundar Bhattacharya became attracted by the grace of most worshipful Sri Srila Prabhupada and began visiting the Gaudiya Mutt located at No. 1 Ultadanga Road in Kolkata to take advantage of the good fortune of hearing Harikatha from his lotus mouth and pursuing the true purpose of human life. He listened to Srila Prabhupada's discourses with rapt attention. Before long, he offered his full participation to the above-mentioned Sri Gaudiya Mutt established in December of 1926 and became a recipient of Srila Prabhupada's special affection. In the month of Vaishakh, April, Sri Ramendra Sundar Bhattacharya received initiation into the chanting of Sri Harinam Mahamantra from Srila Prabhupada. And on the 26th day of Shravan, August, he was awarded Mantra Diksha according to Pancharatrika conventions. His initiated name was Sri Ramananda Das. Very soon after, in the year of 1930, Srila Prabhupada, noting Sri Ramananda Das's exclusive dedication to practices of bhajan on which he had been instructed, his genuine attachment to the service of Sri Guru and the Vaishnavas, and his exceptional expertise in delivering the truths of scriptures according to Srila Prabhupada's current of thought, granted him Tridan Sannyas and gave him the name Srimad Bhakti Raksha Shridhar, which means the guardian of devotion and the emissary of its beauty. Srila Maharaj has truly fulfilled the meaning of this name, and thus, by the blessings of Sri Guru, has become revered worldwide. His exceptional ability, all virtues befitting a Vaishnav, were resplendent in him. By the grace of Srila Guru, one obtains the grace of the Lord, and additionally, all the demigods along with their virtues take up residence in one who is exclusively devoted to the Lord. Although he was born in an aristocratic Brahmin family with ample luxuries, erudition and physical beauty, we never saw him display any sort of arrogance in the mud regarding his birth or learning. The calm and composed manner in which he somberly refuted before vast assemblies of scholars the misconceptions opposing devotional scriptures was exceptional, as was his ability to then establish the proper conceptions. His thesis like discourses, as a result of hearing Pujyapad Sridhar Maharaj unparalleled and analytic sermons of devotional scriptures such as Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, many earnest and pious members of affluent society attained the fortune of succeeding in life's true purpose by taking shelter of Srila Prabhupada's lotus feet. Each and every one of his discourses was like a thesis. Anyone could have easily earned a doctorate degree simply by studying the notes of his classes. His unprecedented explanation of Brahma Gayatri, as referenced in the Garuda Puran, Srimad Bhagavatam is the commentary of Brahma Gayatri, the mother of all Vedas. In accordance with the verdict of Srimad Bhagavatam, Pujyapad Sridhar Maharaj explained Brahma Gayatri as a meditation on the lotus feet of Sri Radha. Sri Radha Padam Dhimahi. The unprecedented elegance of this explanation is revered throughout the community of refined scholars who are adept at transcendental sentiments, rasa. In Srimad Bhagavatam 10.30.28, while searching for Krishna, the gopis state, Anne Radhito Nunam, this fortunate maiden has surely worshipped Aradhita Bhagwan Hari, since she is acclaimed as having truly worshipped Krishna, which means he finds bliss in her. Can there be any way to attain the lotus feet of Sri Krishna other than taking shelter exclusively of Swarup Shakti, this intrinsic potency of his, which is the personified potency of bliss Haladini? This in itself is the amorous worship devised by the maidens of Braj. Brajvadu Vargena Yakalpita. Srila Bhakti Thakur has written, Radha Bhajane Jadi Mati Nahi Bhela, Krishna Bhajane Tav Akaran Gela. If your mind does not incline towards the worship of Radha, your worship of Krishna has been in vain. This alone is the instruction of Sri Guru Pad Padma, who is eminent among the followers of Sri Sarup Damodar Goswami and Srila Rup Goswami Pad. Reciting this instruction as if it were a mantra causes the witch of illusion to flee. Bhagavad Gita 10.10 states, Dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upyanti te. I grant them the true intelligence and understanding by which they can attain me. This statement refers to pure, determined intelligence aimed at attaining the eternal service of Sri Bhagavan, for which one must pray to Gayatri Devi, the mother of the Vedas. This explanation manifested in Pujyapad Maharaj's heart by the mercy of Sri Radha's eternal associate, his Sri Guru, who identified himself as Sri Vrishabhanu Daita Das, the servant of the beloved of Sri Vrishabhanu's daughter. According to the primary meaning of the words of the Vedas, श्यामम चबलम प्रबद्धे, शबलम श्यामम प्रबद्धे, द क्विंट एसेंस ऑफ लॉर्ड्स इंट्रिंसिक पोटेंसी, स्वरूप शक्ति ऑफ ब्लिस टेक्स रेफ्यूज विद इन श्री कृष्ण एंड श्री कृष्ण टेक्स रेफ्यूज इन द एसेंस ऑफ दैट ब्लिसफुल एनर्जी हलादनी. When this logical understanding can be deduced from the above, what is the point of speculating and applying the secondary meaning of the word Shama, which is Hard Brahmatva, or the all-pervasive monist spirit within the heart? The true intent of Brahm Gayatri is to meditate on the lotus feet of Sri Radha, Sri Radha Padam Dhimahi. It is only when one adheres to this understanding that the lotus feet of Sri Radhanath, the master of Sri Radha, that is Sri Shyamasundar, become attainable. That personality alone is the absolute truth. Srila Sridhar Maharaj has thus received ubiquitous acclaim for his purport on Gayatri, an object of differential regard. Pujyapad Maharaj was so well adept at bhajan that the great majority of eminent sannyasis, brahmacharis, grastas and vanprasthis devotees of our Gaudiya Math mission treated him with deferential regard and experienced great joy in discussing matters of the Lord with him. The worshipful Nityalila Purvish Tridandi Goswami, Srimad Bhakti Pragyan Kesha Maharaj and Nityalila Purvish Pujyapa Tridandi Goswami, Srimad Bhakti Sarang Goswami Maharaj both accepted Tridanda Sannyas from Param Pujyapad Srimad Bhakti Rakshar Sridhar Goswami. During his manifest presence, the world-renowned Tridandi Swami, Srimad Bhakti Vedan Swami Maharaj, who accepted Tridanda Sannyas from Pujyapad Keshav Maharaj and extensively preached the message of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the Western countries, establishing many temples worldwide, showed great regard for his senior godbrother, Pujyapa Sridhar Maharaj, recognizing him as an expert in bhajan, and he rejoiced in visiting him to hear Krishna Katha whenever he was able. His natural genius. In school, Pujyapa Sridhar Maharaj simultaneously learned Sanskrit and English under the tutelage of highly learned mentors. Since he was born in a celebrated family of scholars, his natural genius in composing Sanskrit poetry was noted at an early age. And under the shelter of our most worshipful Srila Prabhupada, this innate, God-given ability only blossomed further. Srila Prabhupada, during his manifest presence, would express his immense pleasure to read verses Srila Maharaj composed. Srila Prabhupada, during his manifest presence, would express his immense pleasure to read verses Srila Maharaj composed, especially his Srimad Bhakti Vinod Vira Dashakam. By reading several of his poetic Sanskrit compositions, such as Shri Shri Prabhupada Padma Stavak, Shri Daita Das Pranati Panchakam, Shri Shri Daita Das Dashakam, and Shri Shri Prabhupada Pranitaha, it is easy to grasp the extent of that staunch, compelling devotion and attachment he nurtured for his Gurupad Padma. Aside from these, he composed Srimad Gaur Kishore Namaskar Dashakam, Srimad Roop Pad Raja Prathana Dashakam, Srimad Nityanand Dwadashakam, Srila Gadadhar Prathana Rik Tat Parayam, Sri Gayatri Nirgalitartham, Sri Prem Dham Deva Stotram, and Sri Gaur Sundar Nuti Sutram, all of which are highly revered throughout the Sri Gaudiya Vaishnava community. Two of Srila Prabhupada's dear associates, the exalted Vaishnava Nityalila Purvish Shripad Krishna Das Babaji Maharaj, who was always immersed in the bliss of bhajan, and Tridandi Goswami Srimad Bhakti Vichar Yayavar Maharaj, had a special appreciation for the above mentioned compositions and would sing and relish them with great enthusiasm. The compiler of a poetic gem. In Srila Maharaj Sri Prem Dham Deva Stotram, almost all of Sriman Mahaprabhu's pastimes, from Adi to Ante, beginning to end, are recorded in brief, published on its own as a book, with word-for-word purports and translations. This poetic gem of a stotra would prove to be sizable devotional literature worthy of regular study. The Vaishnavs also sing with great honor. The Bengali songs he composed describing Shri Gaur Sundar's birth, such as Aruna Vasana Sonar Suraj, in which he describes Shri Chaitanya Dev as golden sun wearing a saffron cloth. His contribution for the Brihad Mridanga. Under Pujyapad Maharaj's editorial direction, the entire Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu had been translated into Bengali and published with Sanskrit verses, commentary and anvaya, word-for-word translation that follow the sentence structure. Besides this, he has published Srimad Bhagavad Gita, his Parpanna Jivanamrita, a collection of Sanskrit verses regarding Sharanagati from various scriptures, as well as several other books, both in Bengali and English. These books have been widely distributed and well received by Western academics. It has been a matter of great joy for us to see that so many earnest, pious seekers, having come from the West to Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math in Shridham, Mayapur, have been attracted by hearing Pujyapad Maharaj's delivery of the message of pure devotion, and have thus gained the fortune of receiving the shelter of his lotus feet. They tape recorded many of his instructions delivered in while he was either partially or fully confined to bed, and later published those recordings as books, which have been well received by the English-speaking academia. With heartfelt and spirited effort, these devotees have established preaching centers in such places as London, whereby Sri Srila Prabhupada's message of pure devotion is being widely propagated. Although Maharaj remained in one place throughout most of his life, amazingly he served to fulfill Shriman Mahaprabhu's prediction, Prithvite Ache Jat Nagar Adi Gram Sarvatra Prachar Hoi Bemora Naam. My name will be propagated in every town and village all over this earth. A true follower of Srila Saraswati Thakur, the day before Sri Srila Prabhupada disappeared, he blessed Pujyapad Sridhar Maharaj with the order of singing Srila Narottam Das Thakur Maharshi's Shri Rupa Manjari Pada and various other songs. Pujyapad Maharaj carried that merciful blessing on his head throughout his life, and until the moment he disappeared, dedicated his life to fulfilling the heartfelt ambition of Prabhupada. The foremost of the followers of Sri Sarup Damodar Goswami and Srila Rup Goswami Pad, just days before Srila Prabhupada disappeared, he said, "The legacy of Sri Bhaktivinoda Thakur will never be checked. You must all pledge yourself to propagate the ambition of Srila Bhaktivinoda with even more enthusiasm." Thakur Bhaktivinoda is our exalted predecessor and the foremost of the followers of Srila Rup Goswami Pad. Our most worshipful Prabhupada set the magnificent idol of fulfilling Thakur Bhaktivinoda's cherished desire. His dearest disciples, Pujyapad Tirth Maharaj, Goswami Maharaj, Madhav Maharaj, Van Maharaj, Yayavar Maharaj, Krishna Das Babaji Maharaj, Sridhar Maharaj, and other prominent Vaishnava Acharyas have emulated that idol and have come to be counted among the followers of Srila Prabhupada, the follower of Sri Rupa Goswami Pad. Now that Sri Srila Prabhupada and many of his associates have entered the Lord's eternal pastimes, if the servant of his servants wish to attain his lotus feet, they must be dauntless in cultivating their hope to fulfill the innermost desire of Sri Guru. In this task, the dust of the feet of the Rupanuga Vaishnavas, the water that has washed their feet, and the remnant of their food shall be our sole source of strength and courage. His dedicated sevakas. During Srila Sridhar Maharaj's pastime of illness, the manner in which his eastern and western disciples preoccupied themselves with serving his sacred form day and night was truly amazing, incredible, and exemplary. Following the example of Sri Srila Ishwar Puripad's service to Sri Srila Madhavendra Puripad during his final days, several young Bengali sevakas, especially one boy named Tapan, offered their body, mind, and words in the service of their guru in an extraordinary manner, thus becoming recipients of their Gurudev's boundless merciful blessings. My good fortune. 4 days prior to Pujyapad Maharaj's disappearance, on Monday, 8 August, It so happened that I was fortunate enough to be present in Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math to have darshan of Pujyapal Sridhar Maharaj. I stayed there until his disappearance and was blessed to be in his proximity every so often and render some service. The ritual aspect of his samadhi ceremony was performed under my direction. Our grand misfortune. Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami has captured in verse form the words Sriman Mahaprabhu spoke in the context of Sri Srila Namacharya Haridas Thakur's passing. Kripa Kori Krishna Mor Diyachilo Sangha Swatant Krishnar Icha Hoilo Sangha Bhanga Sri Chaitanya Chaitamrita Antalila 11.94. Mercifully, Krishna gave me, that means Haridas Thakur's association. By Krishna's independent will, our exchange has ended. Haridas Achilo Prithvir Ratna Shiromani Taha Bina Ratna Shunne Hoilo Medini Sri Chaitanya Chaitamrita Antalila 11.97. Haridas was the crown jewel of this earth. Without him, it is as if she is bereft of all jewels. Today we have lost an intimate associate of our most worshipful Prabhupada. Remembering the pastime of Thakur Haridas' passing, we have become submerged in an ocean of grief. The void created by his absence can never be filled. It is our great misfortune that the supremely effulgent suns of the Saraswat Gaudiya sky are disappearing one by one, casting that sky under the cover of darkness. Alas, alas, we are gradually being deprived of guardians and caretakers. I see the cloud of all fallacy and illusion is beginning to cover the sun of pure devotion, truth, once again. Who will selflessly show me compassion in his absence? In the course of their dialogue, Sriman Mahaprabhu asked his associate, Srila Rai Ramananda, Dukh madde kon dukh hai gurutar? Among all sorrows, which sorrow is the greatest? This evoked the answer. Krishna bhakta vira vina dukh nahi dekhi par. I cannot think of any sorrow greater than that experienced in the separation from Krishna's devotees. Truly, there is no limit to the pain of separation from Krishna's devotees, nor is there any consolation. Who but a devotee of Krishna, whose life belongs to Krishna, who is veritable ocean of compassion, and is fully empathic. He feels the pain of others and suffers when he sees the suffering of others, while strive to deliver the souls who have lost Krishna and led them in his direction by speaking Harikatha. Who else will selflessly try to dispel the ghost of delusion afflicting such a fallen, miserable soul as I, who am blinded and bewildered? The associates of Sri Gaurhari. Devotion alone is the supreme function of all souls. As corruptive misconception enter devotion, an outbreak of irreligion occurs. It is to dispel this perversion and reinstate the pure principles of religion that Sri Bhagwan incarnates in every age along with his associates. In the interim, he sends his devotees to preach pure dharma and thereby manifest his compassion for living entities. Thus, the supremely compassionate Sri Gaurhari sent his associates Sri Srila Thakur Bhakti Vinod, Sri Srila Prabhupada Saraswati Goswami Thakur and, more recently, their associates Pujyapal Sridhar Madhav Maharaj and other such personalities to effect the establishment of pure religion. A piteous prayer at his lotus feet. Alas, today as they gradually disappear from view, we have become totally bereft of our protectors. O Gaur Sundar, please protect us. Surely Pujyapal Sridhar Maharaj has arrived in the presence of Param Aradhe, Prabhupada's worshipful lotus feet, and has become engaged in his eternal service. My piteous prayer at his lotus feet is that he cast a glance of mercy from there upon this wretched and destitute individual. Vaishnavas ignore the fault of others. We therefore humbly and pitifully pray at Pujyapal Sridhar Maharaj's lotus feet that he may forgive and rectify any offenses, mistakes or oversights we may have committed, either knowingly or unknowingly. He has become engaged in the eternal service of Sri Srila Prabhupada एंड सो आई सबमिट दिस प्रेयर एट हिज फीट. मे ही मर्सीफुली फुलफिल आवर लाइव्स बाय ग्रांटिंग अस क्वालिफिकेशन टू सर्व द लोटस फीट ऑफ प्रभुपाद एंड प्रभुपाद एसोसिएट्स. एक्सर्प्ट्स फ्रॉम एन आर्टिकल पब्लिश इन श्री चैतन्य वाणी ईयर 28 वॉल्यूम 7.